Thank you for the introduction, and I have nothing to declare. So this talk is prepared jointly with Dr. Dong Liang. So I'm gonna talk about the, so we heard so much about deep learning, and so I'm gonna talk about particularly on image acquisition and reconstruction. So we know MRI, when we do a scan, so we have these two steps. First, we're gonna acquire the data, and so through this really complicated hardware and also based on the MR physics. And then once we have data, it does not look anything like an image yet, so we have to do some computation and to generate image, so that's image reconstruction. And we know that, so currently the one long-standing issue is the MRI is pretty long to do the scan. So that's created several issues. For example, for patients it's uncomfortable, and also the can cause image artifacts if there's any motion. And also it's a really big issue for healthcare because it's expensive to do. And so a lot of effort being made in this community to try to make it faster. And so we know historically, like a lot of pulse sequence being designed based on physics to make it faster. And so then a little bit more recently, so we know there's a parallel imaging, and so we have the hardware to make it to make a fast imaging more possible. And so then this, in the past decade, we know there's a really huge effort on image reconstruction based with the prior knowledge, so incorporate constraint like the sparsity and the low rank, so that's the more like compressed sensing. And so then why do we still need like a deep learning, machine learning type of method for this? And so first of all, we are still not happy with the speed. So then, you know, we really made a lot of progress, and so we can do acquisition much faster than a few years ago. And however, so we cannot do the real time imaging like the ultrasound does. So that's our goal. And so currently we know there's still a lot of information, so extra information that underutilized. For example, we know all the images we have, so we have like high dimensional and a lot of them, and they are really highly redundant. So they're really information we can exploit there. And so we scan many images every day, like in every machine, and so some of them are really come from the same protocol and the same part of the organ, and so it's like a lot of repetition there. And so, and also for even like a certain patient, so maybe that patient might go through several modalities to get images. So we have a really lot of information there. And also we know the MR physics so well, and so for example, block equation, we know it's really, a good description of the MR physics. And so now of this have been really fully utilized in the reconstruction and also the acquisition very well. So we want to use machine learning and then take advantage of all those information. And so to apply machine learning to accelerate MRI, so we can go from the acquisition side. And I would say this is really very, very open, still pretty new. And I would say like barely work on this area. So I would say, for example, maybe the MRI fingerprinting is kind of along that line. And so there's an auto-seq that works that will be presented in this conference. So that's so I believe the smart, kind of smart pulse sequence design based on the physics, that will be also a very interesting area to further explore, because it's still quite open. And so in terms of reconstruction, it's also kind of new compared to the classification. We know that image analysis, those being explored using the machine learning a lot more than the reconstruction. And so in that case, we can address several issues with the current reconstruction method using analytical model. And so then we can fully utilize the learning capability. So for example, I will focus on that. I will introduce three different aspects. For example, we can learn the reconstruction parameters, and or we can just learn the model. We said we can use some constraint for reconstruction and how to learn those kind of constraint. And then the third type is like end to end, so we just don't need to know anything in between, and so we just go from the data to the images. So I focus on the last one when I get to the details. So that's the three type of reconstruction that can utilize machine learning. And so some work being focused on like earlier to really like learn this. So compressed sensing been studying for quite a while, and so but we know we need to tune parameters so very carefully. And so some work been working on like how to really use learning to get that parameter really learned well. And then there's model learning. So I think that, so like Dr. Fessler been mentioning, so there's some work to either use dictionary learning or more complicated learning to learn that prior information. So that's more like unsupervised learning where we don't have the ground truth. And so then the last category, so we learn from end to end. So over there, so the focus will be, we have to have training data, so we have to have ground truth to start with. And then we learn this whole reconstruction algorithm end to end from data, from raw data to image. So we model that as a deep neural network, and then we learn that network from through training. So that usually require a lot of training data. And so I start with the math or the reconstruction model. So we know, usually when we do reconstruction, we first need a forward model for the imaging system. So that's from our image to the data. So the image X, and so then our imaging system would create the measurement Y. And so usually we have a mathematical model for that. And so to do image reconstruction, then we have to come up with the algorithm R so that it will be able to generate or recover the image X from based on the measurement. And so then if we plug into the reconstructed image back to the forward model, and so it will give us some error which we would want it to be small. And so then the first type of machine learning method would still try to kind of simulate the compressed sensing framework. So, but then they so try to optimize or learn these parameters use deep learning. So, a few work have been done along this line, and those we still need the forward model. We still need to know the imaging model, and also usually we should need a prior knowledge to start with. So like total variation type of model to start with, and so then the second type I mentioned is that we want to learn this constraint that used for compressed sensing type of reconstruction. So we know we need some prior information to incorporate in the reconstruction. So here I just give an example that our group been working on is to model this unknown image as manifold. And so we learn the manifold using some navigator data. So that is that does not need a prior to acquire some image for training. So it's like more like online learning, and then we can incorporate that learned manifold model as constraint to do the final optimization, and then combine with data consistency, then we can reconstruct the image. So again, here it's more like the unsupervised learning because we don't need the gold standard to start with, but here we need the forward model of the imaging system to enforce the data consistency. And so here show some results that we had. So that's for Cine, and so the top row is the from simulated data, and then the last row is the in vivo data. So then we compare with the partial separability model, which is also kind of based on the PC. So it's also kind of unsupervised learning technique, but manifold is like more general model for that. So we see some improvement over that. And so then the focus of this talk will be on the deep learning. So this is really the title of this session. So most of the work on deep learning is, so we try to really model the whole reconstruction algorithm as a neural network. And so then we really, so it's more like a black box, so we don't really care about what's happening in between. And so we don't even need the forward model of the imaging system. So mathematically, you can look at this. We are really solving this the optimization problem, and where we want the so as I mentioned before. So R is like the reconstruction algorithm, but now it's a network, and with some parameters. So for example, for the convolutional neural network, so that can be the filter weight, and so the activation functions. So those are something we're gonna optimize. And so we want to use this network, operate on the data, and so then we recover or reconstruct the image. So we want the reconstructed image to be close to the ground truth image we start with. So that's through training, and since we have a lot of training data, so N would represent the different training data set. So we want to kind of, do this optimization where some regularization, like Dr. Park, like earlier mentioned, so we need some regularization also on this those parameters. So that's the, mathematical formulation of the training. And so once we have this network, so we know the parameters, and so then we build the whole network. So once we have new data coming in, so the training, we know both sides, right? The measurement and the ground truth image. And so once we have new data, we don't know the image, we just have the measurement. So we put into that network, and then we will get the reconstructed image back. So that's the idea there. And so some kind of open questions I want to discuss briefly. And so like training set, and so what kind of network would be good, and so like how deep we want to go. And then at the end, I will give you some examples on different applications. So the training set, so that's kind of still open, and so especially for the reconstruction, so it's still under explored. And so, what is the optimal size? Of course, that always depends on problem. So we know, but this is true that we know if we have really large network, for example, convolutional neural network, but we don't have enough training data set, that will really cause problems. So it will lead to overfitting. So that at that time, we have to really regularize that network heavily. And so in the literature, we've been, looking at, so that's usually use at least hundreds of images for the training, for the reconstruction problem. And so So, but the good part is that usually we know the forward model, so we can generate training data if we don't have the ground truth and measurements at the same time. So we can really kind of do the simulation to generate training data, get more. And so another way is the transfer learning, so that can help us if we don't have enough training data to start with. So then, some work already kind of use that idea, like the AutoMap work. So they use the natural images from the image net, so like a cat's dog, and for training, and so that's still good for the brain images or medical images we gonna reconstruct. And also the work that train through CT images and then do more kind of refine the learning than for MRI images. So that is some work along the training. And so in terms of our network, so as we learned earlier, so the convolution neural networks are mostly widely used for the to deal with images. And so also the risk reconstruction part, a lot of work have been using the CNN. But there are also other networks, like a residual neural network and the generative adversarial network. So those have been recently also explored. So those are all forward networks. That means we always go from one direction to another, from the starting point to the end. And so there are also recurrent networks where there's loops that you can utilize. And so layers. So then, earlier we learned that the deeper would be better. So a lot of theoretical paper already investigate that. So that's well known. However, it's depending on the problem, we also have to be careful on that because if we don't have enough training data to start with, then the deeper might not be better. And also then if we have deeper network, then we have to train that well, and that also take long to train. So we did some kind of investigation along that. So for the end-to-end deep learning reconstruction, so we kind of try different layers, and then and also we keep the training time to be constant because we don't want to really, and so keep the training time and the training data set to be fixed, and we try different layers and we find really a trade-off. So it's you don't really want to go too deep, and so in this particular case we find 15 layers would give us best performance. And so that's so next I move to a few examples. So really the deep learning for reconstruction has been explored in a few applications. So let's start with the earliest paper to investigate this end-to-end deep learning for reconstruction. So this paper published in ISB. And so here is, so as mentioned earlier, so we just treat this reconstruction as a deep network. And so compared to the conventional reconstruction, like the initial linear reconstruction, we know it's very fast, but then scan time is long, and then the compressing-based method is make a scan faster, but then the reconstruction is long. So now with deep learning, we want to have the benefit of short scan time and also very short reconstruction time, where the learning is long, but it can be done on offline, so which is not a big issue. And so some initial results from that paper. So then we have the network. So we have really some poor reconstruct, like undersampled the data to start with, and so the image would be like have artifacts, and so it goes through the network, and so we can get a pretty good reconstruction. So that's for reduction factor of 3. And so then we know, like recently, this AutoMap published in Nature. So that's like more, so to look at the problem in more depth. And so then I would say the main, so they look at the training more carefully, like so they use the image from ImageNet instead of we have to really scan like for with the same protocol or same part of the body again for training data. So it's really can use transfer learning to borrow from natural images. And so also then they also identify that same network can be used for different acquisition. For example, for so if we just want to use the deep learning to network to represent inverse Fourier transform, so we build a network to do that, and so we can really, without the knowledge of any Fourier transform, this math at all, so we just have the training data, the pairs, and so then we can do the Fourier reconstruction very well. And so then, so that's just learn the basic Fourier transform, but this same network can be used, the structure can be used to train other kind of reconstruction from different acquisitions. So for example, the radio acquisition and spiral, and so undersample the Fourier or even the misaligned the Fourier acquisition, so they can use the same network but different training data to generate the net to find the network parameter and then do the reconstruction. And so they demonstrate this superior to the conventional method for each of the different acquisition method. And so this is an example for the transfer learning by the CAS group. And so then we have, so they use the CT images as the training data. So there's a lot of them to start with. And so then they build network and then find the network parameter. And so then they just use very few MRI slices to kind of refine and adapt to this new MRI data. And so then they generate some also some nice results compared with, so that's what they had, and compared with the some other like TV and focus algorithm. So this shows some improvement. And also Dong Liang's group did this dictionary learning for parallel imaging. So then so they start with the multi-channel undersample data and as the input, and then the fully reconstructed image, like a single channel as the output, and they build this network and train, and then once they get the parallel imaging data, just plug it into to get a new image. And so that's some results that they compare with the a traditional method like Guapa Spirit, L1 Spirit, and so see the significant improvement, and also the reconstruction time. So that's CPU time. So we see it's really beneficial in that sense. And this work by people in Empire College at London. So it's they did some work on the dynamic MRI using deep learning. So again, they have dynamic images and map to the output also dynamic images. But then they did undersampling for each frame, and so then they use the convolutional neural network with the 3D convolutional kernel. And so then here's some results. Also, they compare with a few standard method. And so that's the deep learning would give you compared to the ground truth, so we see this error is in the list. And also, in terms of the CPU time, it's very efficient because all the computation was done in the training part offline. And so also some work done on multi-contrast MRI, so then we can utilize the images from different contrasts, and then so again, so there's another sample for each of those contrasts, and also our channels, and then we can learn the network and eventually reconstruct all different contrasts simultaneously. And so some results, so we have the proton density T1, T2 weighted to reconstruct it simultaneously, and so that's the deep learning results. And so compared to the just using parallel imaging, we see some improvement there. And so some very recent results on parameter mapping use deep learning, so they use ResNet, and so to kind of train these from undersampled the data at different echo, and so this is for T2 mapping, and so that's a reference, and then this is a reconstruction from undersampled data, and but goes through this ResNet, and so we see some improvement over the traditional reconstruction method. Okay, so I give you a few examples, and so some thoughts based on what we seen, and so we know the so compress sensing had been a kind of mainstream before for the reconstruction, and so we see here there's some benefits to use this end-to-end deep learning method, and so image quality is better, and one key advantage would be it's insensitive to the parameter we're gonna select for compress sensing. We know there's a lot of parameter tuning, and also the training data not so we used to think, okay, we have to use the same type of images for training, but so the work showing we actually don't have to, and so it's not very sensitive to where we use for training. And also another huge benefit is the reconstruction time. It can be very, very short, so that's really good for the like real-time acquisition and the reconstruction, so we can eventually achieve something like a real-time observation of the moving object. And so again, there are also limitations, and so one is we always need a huge amount of training data to do the training, and so that's also very time-consuming to train. But fortunately, it can be performed online, and then training data can be acquired prior to this study. And so then the and so currently we so whatever the training data provide us, we can only observe what the knowledge we have is just from there. So if there anything beyond the training data information training data provided, then we might get lost. So that's another issue. And so we see that so the like deep learning already done something like we never think possible. So like self-driving car. And so we also expect this deep learning, for example, for reconstruction can give us really radical improvement. But now we still only see like similar kind of acceleration can be achieved, similar to the compressed sensing. So, you know, is that possible to push it much harder to get, you know, like a factor of 10, for example, like acceleration. And so the outlook, again, so the like training samples, and so we can also, you know, do more study on that. So what, how many we need, and also the deeper network, better, or we just make the like the filter, more filters for each layer, so deeper or broader. So with more some new network coming up, and so we might want to explore like really what kind of network is best for our problem for acquisition and reconstruction. And so to combine with the domain knowledge, because now we mainly treat it as a black box, and so we don't really know what's going on there. So it's kind of difficult to combine with some other domain knowledge. And so eventually, do we want to go like on supervised learning? Because here it's really supervised. So that's so with that, I want to thank people who provided me slides, and also thank you for your attention.